So just a little bit of background about who I am. I work at the Philene Research Institute, which is the think tank for the credit union system in North America. We serve the research and development needs of credit unions. And I just thought I'd give you a little bit of background about credit unions, because it's a little bit misunderstood about what credit unions do, how big they are, what kind of scale and scope they are. But let me just ask, how many people here are individually a member of a credit union? Okay. Well, that's a lot more than you typically get in a room. So that's a good thing. I just thought I'd give you some statistics. There are approximately 7,000 independent credit unions here in the United States, with about 95 million separate accounts slash members. Realistically, if you look at that number, about a third of them are extremely active and would consider their credit union their primary financial institution. So it kind of gives you the scale and scope of what credit unions are. It represents about $1 trillion in assets, and anytime you put $1 trillion on the table, it seems like a lot, but in the grand scheme of things, that's about the same asset size as some of the largest banks in our country. Bank of America, Chase, are about $1 trillion or more in assets. So you have 7,000 institutions representing about the same amount of assets as some of the large banks. And as a result, we only have about 10% market share in the United States, regardless of whether you're looking at savings or loans or specific types of loan products. And that market share has been relatively stable over the past 25 years. And that's all within the context of credit unions have extremely high satisfaction levels. Over the past 25 years, there's been a survey that the American Bankers Association has done comparing banks and credit unions, and every year credit unions outrank banks in terms of satisfaction, such to the point that the ABA has stopped doing the survey. But it's a conundrum, because we have this high satisfaction and high loyalty amongst people that use credit unions, but then the rest of the population, there's very low awareness. And I think the basis of the discussion today is, how can credit unions and other cooperatives, consumer cooperatives and food co-ops being the most visible, how can they collaborate to change that situation both for credit unions and their other sectors? So the folks at CDS asked me to just answer the questions that we've all been answering this morning. Why does growth matter for credit unions? And I thought I would just kind of separate it out into left brain versus right brain, so kind of head and heart. And I guess if it's stage left, is kind of the logical reason why growth is really important. And it probably looks a lot like this for food co-ops, is that, well, number one, we have actually no access to capital. One of the most exciting things that I was a part of as a member of the Willie Street Co-op board is that we issued bonds. We actually asked members for money, and within 38 days, we got $1 million to expand to our second store, which is cool, which is great. And I know a lot of you issue preferred shares that come with specific dividends. Credit unions, as financial institutions, are absolutely not allowed to access any other secondary forms of capital other than retained earnings. So if a credit union does not grow, literally, they will go out of business. So that's one of the reasons why growth is so important for credit unions. Number two, financial services is a scale business. You know, the procurement of financial services, it requires a lot of scale, because the investments required from a regulatory, a technology, and a communications perspective scales up quite nicely, because essentially we're in a digital business. You know, with the exception of people going into a branch and getting money from an ATM, it's essentially zeros and ones that we're dealing with. And if you're a $5 million institution, you have to provide the same types of services as a $1 trillion institution. So scale is quite important in financial services. And then finally, competition. It's important for us to grow, because consumers demand a lot more, because they've become used to dealing with larger financial institutions that continue to add on lots of services that people may not necessarily think that they need, but they want, because other financial institutions provide that. So in the context of where credit unions are competing, in the banking industry, we have almost the exact same number of financial institutions on the banking side. So the United States is an oddball of a country when it comes to financial services. We have about 14,000 separate financial institutions in this country, about 7,000 credit unions and about 7,000 banks. Banks are much, much larger. But then when you look at a place like Canada, I was working with some Canadian credit unions earlier this week. They have about five banks, five large national banks, and about 300 to 400 separate credit unions. So we're just an oddball, and we have these very localized institutions. Now, if you look at it from a more emotional side of things, credit unions need to grow because they're a really great counterweight to the banking industry. In our institution, we do a lot of research comparing banks to credit unions. And what we find through a variety of research that I won't bore you with, but some of the more interesting things is that throughout a variety of business cycles, up cycles, down cycles, this great recession that we just went through, credit unions remain relatively stable throughout all of those cycles. So they continue to lend even in down cycles, and they don't get over exuberant in up cycles. So it's a really nice counterweight to what the banking industry provides. Secondly, you know, there's a lot more consumer demand for credit unions, and consumers are demanding credit unions to provide the services that they want because they just want more. So, for example, a lot of you can now take a picture of a check and deposit it remotely. It's remote deposit capture. It's a really nifty thing, and it kind of obviates the need for going into branches, which are really costly and very inconvenient, but it costs a lot of money to do that. So we need to grow in order to be able to invest in that. And then finally, and this is, I think, from a completely unbiased perspective, because we've done a lot of research on this, but growth is important because it's really better for consumers. The research that we've done has proven time in and time out, regardless of how we measure it, whether it be pricing on deposits or pricing on loans or service, credit unions are just better for consumers, and we can quantify what the benefit would be for a consumer to go to an average credit union versus an average bank, and it's thousands of dollars a year for consumers. So that's another imperative for growth within credit unions. When we talk about the other question is, well, how do credit unions engage with the community? And I think that this is a key opportunity for credit unions to learn a lot from the food co-op sector and other cooperative sectors, is that we don't do a great job. We used to do a great job historically. We used to be very small. We used to be have high affinity groups within our membership, but we've kind of lost that a little bit. So let me just kind of talk about on the left-hand side, how do we engage with the community? Credit unions do a wonderful job of getting out into the community, into schools, and doing financial education. So going into classrooms or putting on free workshops and getting people engaged that way. One of the problems with that is that sometimes the methodologies are not especially effective. So imagine someone working in a credit union that's maybe 55 years old trying to teach a bunch of high school kids how to balance a checkbook, right? You can kind of see how that's going to go. So there's a lot of activity there, and we need to change. But that's one of the key ways that we engage. The second is that there are still a lot of credit unions that have this thing they call a common bond, and that's how most credit unions started. Is usually through an employer or an affinity group. And over the years, a lot of these employers have gone out of business, which has required credit unions to kind of go community. And a lot of you have probably seen that in each of your own communities. So for example, my credit union, the University of Wisconsin Credit Union, was initially started to serve professors at the University of Wisconsin. And then it expanded out into students. And then it expanded out into the entire community. So that's how credit unions tend to engage with the community. And then finally, I think competition allows us to engage more with the community than we would have, because it's no surprise that the banking industry has PO'd a lot of people out there, especially in the past few years with on a large scale, the TARP and the bailouts, but then also just how people are treated and the fees that you get. And it's enabled us to have that discussion that people don't really like to have about finances. You know, we kind of joke, this is the nerdy research joke of the day, it's like the people's most sensitive part of their anatomy is their wallet. And people don't like to talk about their wallet because usually for a great portion of the population it's a really depressing thing, and they don't like to think about their finances. But over the past few years, this has been an opportunity for credit unions to have that conversation, saying there is a better way for you to think about that. Now, in terms of some of the things that you all do that are really good, or that we all do that is really good that credit unions don't do a good job at, is they don't have a very strategic look at corporate social responsibility. Typically what they do is they write a lot of checks, but it's not strategic and it's not focused in on the goals of the organization. And I know the Willie Street Co-op does a great job in that through some of our community grants. We've done a ton of research that's really boring but very eye-opening about our annual meetings in credit unions. It's the your typical rubber chicken dinner, and it's, you know, the average age is probably around 95. If any of you have been to an annual meeting, and then you contrast that to the Willie Street Co-op annual meeting and party, where we get 4,000 people and we have music and we have beer and we have brats. So I think that there's a lot of ways that we can learn to engage with the community. And then finally, I think something of interest to everyone here is that we have a lot of, we have low board turnover and relatively little engagement. The Mississippi Markets individual that was just talking about how the board engages with the membership, you see very little of that in credit unions, and it's a key opportunity for us to kind of learn from each other. I'll close with some thoughts about, and I hope this doesn't offend anybody, about how credit unions and food co-ops can make sweet, sweet love. I think, you know, there's a variety of examples of how credit unions and co-ops are working really well together. Spire Federal Credit Union and a number of the food co-ops in this room have a relationship with a credit card or debit card that creates benefits both for the food co-op and the member. I think that's a really good but fairly simplistic example of how co-ops and food co-ops and credit unions can work together. Another example is Brewery and Outpost. Having a retail location within the food co-op is another example. At the Willie Street Co-op, we have credit union ATMs that just make it convenient for people to get cash. Some of the non-traditional areas, I think, that provide an opportunity is a project that we've been working on. I was just talking with David from Outpost about this, is over the past few years in the credit union world, we have a real problem with attracting the next generation, not just of consumers, but of employees. So the average age of a credit union member right now is 49 years old. 49 years old. And if you think about people that are around that age, your credit needs tend to decrease as you get older. So with credit unions, their business model is that they buy money really cheap and then they sell it a little bit more expensive, right, in the form of loans. So if we're not attracting the next generation, how are we going to survive? So we've built this community. It's called the Cooperative Trust. And if you want to go onto the web, it's just trust.coop, and it's meant to reinvigorate discussion around how can we engage that next generation of consumers and employees in the cooperative model, looking at it from a credit union perspective. But what we've been doing is experimenting with other cross-sector groups. Last year, we worked with the National Cooperative Business Association to bring in people from the wider cooperative sector and start a conversation and connect young leaders, people that are committed to the cooperative sector, and a place where they can learn, connect, and grow in the cooperative sector. So I think that's a really cool opportunity. The next one is a little bit backwards, right? So we see credit unions coming into food co-ops from transactional perspectives. Credit unions are wonderful at building branches and building out retail locations, and they struggle to bring people in. Our local credit union CEO of the UW Credit Union was giving me hell a few years ago when we opened our second retail location. He's like, we open a branch every 6 months, and it's not like a cause for celebration, but you guys get it covered on the front page of the business section in the local paper. How do we get that? So there seems to me, I'm not sure what the business model is, but there seems to me like a really interesting idea of, you've got credit union branches, why don't we put like this concept of what Outpost has with some of their little cafes within the credit union branch. Kind of a cool opportunity. And then the final one is, how can we collaborate together on community and corporate social responsibility initiatives? We're all aligned around the same type of notion around community development and community wealth and community growth. And the connections there may not be as clear, but if you look at some of the research again, there's a very, very, very clear connection between people that are healthy and people that are financially healthy. So I'm not sure what that looks like, but I think that there's a unique opportunity to have that discussion about financial health and wealth and physical health and wealth that credit unions and co-ops can think about together. So I thank you all for the opportunity, and I've really enjoyed this conversation. So thanks a lot, everyone.